going to be talking to you today. So my name is John Kelly. I'm a professor at Loyola University in Chicago. I'm going to be talking to you today about a project I've been working on in collaboration with Nancy Holm, Beth Luber, and BK Sharma from the ISTC, as well as Kurt Spokas from the USDA ARS lab in Minnesota. So I am a microbial ecologist, and my lab uses advanced molecular DNA-based tools to profile complex bacterial communities in environmental systems. So we use DNA markers to look at the taxonomic composition of bacterial communities. And the reason we do this, and the goal of all of my projects, is to try to understand how human activities can affect the taxonomic composition of these communities and their function in the ecosystem. All of my research focuses around those questions. And hopefully I don't have to tell this audience how important microorganisms are to soil ecosystems. But just to remind you, I'll tell you. Microorganisms are very important to soil ecosystems. Okay? Within soil, microbial communities are extraordinarily diverse. 1 gram of soil, it's about 1 teaspoon, contains between 4,000 and 10,000 different bacterial species. So 4,000 to 10,000 species in 1 gram of soil. Those species are not only diverse genetically and taxonomically, they're metabolically diverse. They can carry out different kinds of metabolic processes, utilize different substrates, produce different end products. Within any given soil at any given time, most of these bacteria are going to be inactive, waiting for their chance to do their thing and do their job. So anything that we as humans do to soil ecosystems could impact these communities. And they're very important to soils. They drive nutrient cycling in soils, nitrogen cycling, carbon cycling, phosphorus cycling. They contribute to soil structure formation. And they interact in beneficial ways with plants, ways that enhance plant productivity, plant yield, soil fertility. So if we do things to soil, we need to understand how those activities are going to affect microbial communities. That includes adding biochar to soils. And with biochar especially, if we're considering biochar as a way to sequester carbon and ameliorate greenhouse gas levels and deal with global climate change, we want to understand how the addition of biochar is going to affect the organisms within the soil and potentially the release of some of those greenhouse gases. So there's been a lot of work done on effects of biochar on soil microbial communities. And Janice mentioned this morning. She described it as a dog's breakfast. And I've never heard that expression before, right? But that metaphor hit home for me because I have 2 very large dogs at home, and they will eat anything. Whatever you put in that bowl, they will eat. So I understand that idea. A lot of the studies I've read don't seem to agree with each other. They use different soil types, different biochar types, and they find different results. So in our study, we wanted to do a more comprehensive study looking at different soil types and different biochar types under one set of conditions, and to do something that was applicable to Illinois. So my collaborators went out and chose 11 different soils from different locations across the state of Illinois. So we have these 11 different soils that were studied in this project. These soils varied quite dramatically in physical chemical characteristics, which I've listed up here. In each column, I've highlighted the low and high values for each characteristic. So the blues are the lows and the reds are the highs. So you can see we've got a pretty good range of pH values, organic matter concentrations, cation exchange capacity, nutrient concentrations. So different range of soils. And we had 6 different biochar types that were part of the study, and they're listed up here. In the work I'm going to describe to you today, I'm focused on the corn stover part of this project. So we used corn stover biochar produced via gassification and via pyrolysis. We also looked at simply burnt corn stover and corn stover that was unmodified. It was just ground up, but it was not converted to biochar. And I think this aspect of the project is especially interesting to see how the organic material converted to biochar differs from the unmodified organic material when it gets into soil. The study was based on laboratory incubations. So the people at ISTC set up these incubations. So there's 11 soils, 6 different biochars, and 3 treatments. Control, which means no biochar, 1% biochar addition, and a 5% biochar addition. There were three replicate serum bottles for each of these treatments, and 5 grams of soil per bottle. So there were hundreds of these bottles that you can see pictured here. They were incubated in the lab for 60 days. Head gas samples were periodically taken during those 60 days to measure the fluxes of greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. And at the end of the 60-day incubation, I was sent some of these soil samples to analyze the composition of the microbial communities. I did this via what's called next-generation sequencing technology. So I take the soil sample, I extract the DNA from the soil sample, I amplify the bacterial DNA, specifically the 16S ribosomal RNA gene, which is very useful for identifying bacteria, putting them into groups, and understanding their evolutionary relationships. We did this using primers that are widely used in the field of environmental microbiology, and we sequenced the hell out of these things using the Illumina MiSeq platform. So we processed the sequence data. I'm not going to bore you with these details, but it'll be on the website in case you want to know how we did the processing. What we ended up with after all the processing was 10,000 sequences per sample. So the total data set we were analyzing was about 2.7 million of these DNA sequences. Each sequence is about 250 bases in length. So each sequence represents one bacteria from our sample. So we're essentially randomly sampling these populations, sampling 10,000 individuals from each one of these soil samples. So, I'm going to show you several of these graphs. This is a non-metric, multidimensional scaling ordination of our bacterial community data. On this graph, each of these dots represents one of those bottles, represents the bacterial community in those bottles. On this ordination, if two dots are very close together, they have very similar bacterial communities. They have the same types of species and the same abundance. If there are two points that are far apart on the ordination, they have bacterial communities that are very different or distinct in composition. So in this graph, I've put up all of our data points, but I've colored them simply by soil type. So this includes the controls and the biochar amended soils. So you can see there's a significant influence of soil type on bacterial community composition. You can see the separation of these points by these different colors. So the type of soil you have has a big effect on the types of bacteria you have in those communities. This is a vector analysis that shows you the relative correlation of different physical and chemical variables with the bacterial community composition. So it tells you which physical and chemical characteristics might be influencing the bacterial communities. The longer the line, the more significant a contribution or correlation it has to the community data. So you can see the factors that had a big influence on community composition included things like pH, organic matter concentration, phosphate concentration, and calcium concentration. So if you look at pH, for example, all the dots to the left had a high pH, all the dots to the right on the graph had a lower pH. And there's been lots of studies that showed pH is a big driver of bacterial community composition. So just the soils itself influenced the bacterial community composition. There was also and of some effect of the treatments. In this ordination, I've highlighted with triangles, I hope you can sort of see these, and this was Beth's suggestion, if Beth is around here somewhere, hopefully she's happy with these triangles. Those are the controls that had no biochar added. You can see all the controls are in sort of that middle area of the graph, and some of the treatments have begun to diverge from those no biochar controls. So I'm going to walk through and explain the results for each of the individual treatments. These are the results for the green corn stover, so the not biochar, just the raw green corn stover material when it was applied to the soil. And in all the graphs I'm going to show you now, the yellows are the controls. These are all the soils together. The yellows are the controls, the blue is the 1% addition, the red is the higher 5% addition. So you can see with the green corn stover, the 1% is beginning to shift the community, and the 5% has really shifted the community away from the controls. So a significant influence on composition from 5% addition of green corn stover. This is the burned corn stover, which was, as I understand it from Nancy's discussion yesterday, they just put it in a barrel and lit it on fire. Right? So the burned corn stover, I don't know, something might be going on. There's a little bit of a shift in some of these red dots, not much happening with the blue, the lower concentration. It looks like for some of the soils, there may be an influence of the burned corn stover. And if you narrow it down just to these five soils, those seem to be showing an effect on composition of the burned corn stover. Now, why those five are showing an effect and the other six are not, I'm not sure at this point. This is still very new and fresh data. I put up here all of those soils again. The ones above the line are the ones that showed an effect of the burnt corn stover. The ones below the line did not. If any of you can very quickly see a pattern, please explain it to me, because I don't see anything that jumps out at me as to why the five soils on the top are different from the ones on the bottom. Is it uniformly different between all of them? I mean, yeah, Oakville is a little lower than the others, but there's a tendency for the ones at the bottom to be higher in calcium. So we still have a lot to look through with this data to sort of see if we can figure out why this is happening. Now I'm going to move on to the actual biochars. This is the gassified corn stover. No effect really on bacterial community composition. The yellow dots, the blue dots, the red dots are all right on top of each other. So no shift in community composition over this 60-day incubation from the gassified corn stover. And finally, if we go to the pyrolyzed corn stover, absolutely no change in community composition really at all. All the dots, the yellows, the reds, the blues are completely on top of each other. So when we don't treat the corn stover, we get a shift in community composition. When we do convert it into biochar, it doesn't change the composition of these communities. We can also see this in looking at bacterial community diversity. This is, again, is based on my DNA sequence data. If you look at the 5% green corn stover that shifted the community composition, it's also in general resulting in a decrease in bacterial diversity. So the heights of these bars represent the diversity of each of these communities in each of these bottles. So the 5% corn stover shifted the community composition and decreased diversity. And this fits very well with what we saw for the greenhouse gas flux. This is CO2 flux. So when we add the unmodified corn stover, we get this burst in CO2 being released by the increased metabolic activity of the microorganisms. So we're causing a change in the community composition, and we're getting an increase in CO2 evolution. So it's this 5% corn stover that's causing that effect. We don't see any increase in CO2 evolution with the biochars. Similar result for N2O flux. There's a couple of these sort of outlier points here in the burn corn stover, but if I rescale this graph to highlight the other samples, you can see the real effect that we're seeing here consistently is with the green corn stover at 1 in 5% is higher than the control and for all of the biochars. So again, it's the unmodified material that's causing this effect. And the data for the methane flux is a little bit less clear. We see a little bit of a response with 1% corn stover, not much with the rest of it. So the only place we saw this significant shift in community composition was with the green unmodified corn stover. The other thing we can do with this data is we can ask what bacterial groups are actually changing, like which ones are increasing in abundance and which ones are decreasing in abundance. So this pie chart represents the bacterial communities from each of these treatments. We have on the left the control, the middle is the 1% corn, the one on the right is the 5% corn. And these are the 20 most abundant bacterial classes in these soils. So what you can see is a shift as we go from left to right. Some of the pie sections are getting larger, some of them are getting smaller. Some of the noticeable changes, we see a decrease in acidobacteria. Acidobacteria are very common soil bacteria. They tend to like acidic or low pH conditions. The additions of the biochars to these soils, including this green corn stover, consistently increased pH, so it may be creating conditions that don't favor these acidobacteria. We see a significant increase in alpha proteobacteria, another common group of soil organisms. One of the most numerically dominant groups of alpha proteobacteria in our data set were rhizobiales, which are known for their symbiotic interactions with plant roots. So these guys are increasing with the addition of the green corn stover. We see an increase in sphingobacteria, again, common soil bacteria known for their ability to degrade complex organic compounds, including aromatic compounds, things like that. And increase in actinobacteria. These are another common group of bacteria. They're not, one of the main groups was the actinomycetales. These guys are really common in soil. They include a lot of antibiotic producing bacteria, just sort of coincidentally. And finally, we see a big significant increase in bacillus organisms. Again, really common group of bacteria. So this data is not that revolutionary in terms of these shifts in these groups. I just wanted to sort of show you the kind of data we can get out of this molecular sequence information. So that finishes up the data I have for my talk. Just a quick summary of the results that we saw in this study. We saw that the addition of the unmodified green corn stover resulted in increase in flux of carbon dioxide and nitrous oxide, so an increase in greenhouse gas emissions, significant shift in the composition of the bacterial communities. So when we put in the unmodified plant material, burst in activity, change in composition of communities. But for the biochars, the gassified and pyrolyzed biochars, those stabilized materials, we don't see the increase in greenhouse gas flux. We don't see the shifts in community composition in these 60-day laboratory incubations. From the point of view of greenhouse gas emissions, from being able to sort of sequester carbon, I think this is good news, right? That we're not getting this increase in greenhouse gas flux from the addition of these biochars.